Can we all settle down, please? Anybody for coffee, you can, or tea, you can have it. It will be open. Okay, I think today is the 16th session. Now I'm starting to lose, you know, the count of which session is it. Manish, 16th? Yeah, so... This is the 16th session of Coffee and Conversations, and a big welcome to all of you, and you know, for coming, and in such good numbers. First of all, today happens to be Manish's birthday, so I think we can all wish him a very, very happy birthday. Baki will have post the session. Now, I mean, Manish's contribution to Coffee and Conversations has been immense. I think the main brain and everything behind Coffee and Conversations is Manish. And though the idea came to me, I mean, I can take the credit only up to that. After that, you know, I've been only looking after the administrative part, and that also for the last couple of months been a little busy. But Manish, all the thought behind about the content, the topics and everything, it has been Manish. So I would like to give him and only him the credit. We and me and Varun have been supporting him in all ways, but for the other all aspects, his credit only goes to him. So thank you, Manish, and because it was a meeting which we had about 3 years back, and with, after 1 year I realized about his potential, because he's a very humble person, a lot of humility in him, and it's only another 6 months it took me to, you know, realize that have him here, and we have been, it has been a wonderful start, and we are still sustaining it. So thank you very much. And now before I come to today's topic, we have got two excellent speakers who are in-house speakers again. And Varun is again a co-founder of Coffee and Conversations, because we together had formed this group. And I'm happy that he has agreed finally to be a part of this side speaker also. So without any this thing, let me hand over to Manish, because it's Manish's task to introduce the speakers, to talk about the subject, because I am not so qualified on it. Thank you. May we have Manish, please?
It's a copyright on introduction.
Actually, actually, you know what happens, that, you know, people who work in Jashan, like Gurdeep ji, he doesn't get stressed, he doesn't understand what this topic is.
You're slightly mistaken.
So, I want to actually ask a few questions to you before I start. First is, in the 1960s, there was an age, average age, at which people used to get depressed. What is that age on an average? What do you think, broadly? Average age. In 1960s, it was 29. It was so alarming a problem that time also. In 2015, what is that age come to? Average age. Not the earliest age, but the average age at which people develop clinical depression. 14. So, you know, from 1960s to now, from 29 to 14 years, is average. So obviously, there are people or children who start feeling depressed, including get depressed much earlier.
I think after 30 years, people really got depressed.
So, I will, you know, I was, last week, I was in my room, and I will admit to you that I realized, I thought I was not addicted, but I got addicted to WhatsApp and Facebook and other things. So I was sitting in my room doing nothing but checking WhatsApp messages of inconsequence. And my daughter walks in and she says, I was doing my studies, I want a break, I want to play with you. So half-heartedly I left my phone, kept it aside, because she said, I can't play with you watching your, if you are on your phone. She got me to put it down and I started interacting with her. And I realized deep down there was something in me which was wishing that she goes away so I go back to my phone. And imagine, for a parent, if you ask me as a parent, what do you cherish the most, I say my family. And it's the same family, when a child comes to play with me, I think of it as an interruption to my WhatsApping, which is of inconsequence. So I realize this addiction, you know, is so harmful and so contagious. And now my kids, I have realized that when I go and I want to chat with them, they are playing and they say, yeah, please tell me what you want to say, and they'll keep looking at the devices. This is the onset, this is the beginning of depression. If you lose contact with people and start associating yourself or start finding pleasure and recourse in devices, I think this is maybe the main reason why people get depressed today. So I just wanted to confess about it, and which is why I've kept my phone aside, and I hope that all of you have also kept your phones aside today for this session. So that was one thing I wanted to talk about. Second is, in the morning walks, we get a lot of ideas. So I was walking with Sajid is here at the back. And he asked me, what is the session about? It's stress management. He says, stress in engineering is force by area. So he says, very simple to manage stress. Either you reduce your force or increase the area. Yeah, not reduce the area, increase the area. So the session today, actually, if you ask me, in a nuts and bolts language, is about decreasing the force in the numerator or spreading the area so that stress can be reduced. So that's in nutshell what this topic is about. So the speaker's here, Varun. Is anyone not familiar with Varun? Varun, you're not familiar. So Varun actually has lived his early life in Kashmir. He's a very proud Kashmiri, and he is very fluent with Urdu. So you may hear some couplets in Urdu from him today in the course of the session. He went to IIM Calcutta for his MBA and joined PwC. Then he became the head of what is called as valuation business in Deloitte. And then he became the CEO of a company called American Appraisal, which got taken over by Duff & Phelps. And then he became the CEO of Duff & Phelps. And during a casual conversation two years ago, he told me now he's not just heading India, but heading Southeast Asia and Japan as well. So he's really become a very, very big man during the course of the last 2 or 3 years. And not many people know that he sings. Yeah, he sings, but doesn't agree to sing at Jashan. Maybe that's one reason why this session is important for him. If he sang, he would have not agreed to the session in the first place. So Varun is a very dear friend. He's a very patient listener as well. Lot of my monologues take place thanks to his listening skills, which I guess come from the fact that he's happily married. My other friend, Vinay. So his real name is Vinay Raj Ramachandra. I didn't know this till yesterday. So I used to call him Vinay. So his full first name is Vinay Raj. Vinay Raj is the first name. So Vinay, we met Vinay about a year ago. He had come to Jashan as an audience, and we had some slots. And generally an announcement was made that anyone who wants to sing can sing. And he asked me that he wants to sing. And I said, go ahead and talk to Gurdeep Ji. And he assumed that I hold that position of importance, that if he's told me, it'll get done. The program ended up, he didn't get a chance to sing. And he says, why? I told you, I want to sing. I said, but I told you to tell Gurdeep Ji. He says, but I thought telling you was sufficient. So so finally, we landed up. So in the next program, Vinay got an opportunity to sing. And he sings wonderfully. The irony of the situation is, in his family, his wife is a trained Hindustani singer. His son has learned music for 10 years. He also plays a harmonium. Our friend who sings publicly has never been trained and is now learning music. And they, his family doesn't want to come and sing on public platforms. So he's taken on the onus to represent his family's musical interests in public platforms.
The power of Jashan.
And they don't come to listen to him also.
So Vinay is an engineer, and he's my senior. If you look at, it doesn't become obvious. Only in the last few days, while compiling his biography, we figured out that he's senior to me, significantly senior to me, but it didn't become obvious to anyone. So he's been working in a number of companies. Some of the names are so difficult to pronounce, but he actually very early realized that it's not good to work as an employee. That stresses him a lot. Rather become a contractor. So he started basically working for 4 or 5 months in a year. And he was earning more than he was earning by working 12 months in a job. And since 1996, he's been a contractor. And then he moved back to India in 2011, kept going back to the US to work. And right now, he's enjoying a brief sabbatical, where he's pursuing his other interests. He's professionally learning music. He sings at various platforms. And he's very, very regular with his morning walks and runs. Very inspiring person, very excellent example of how work-life balance has to be maintained. So I think without taking too much of your time, I must now hand over the mics to our two gentlemen. Varun and Vinay. Over to you.
Thanks, Manish. Thanks for a very, very fulsome introduction. Without taking too much more time, maybe I'll start with a question to the audience. Actually, we probably need the mic for the audience. What I'd like you to do is to tell me a little bit about your expectations from this session. Thanks, first of all, for taking the time to come on a Sunday morning, beautiful Sunday morning, maybe a little warm, but still beautiful. So obviously, there are some expectations from this session. What would you like to get out of it? And if there is something that you want to share with us to begin with, that would be very helpful to us to sort of structure the session. We've already got it in some kind of structure, but obviously we can tweak it and make some changes based on what your expectations are. So raise a hand and I'll get the mic to you. Anybody wants to share their expectations from the session today?
Zero expectations. That's a question.
I think we all came with an open mind.
Open mind. Excellent. That's it. So then, Sachin.
I think many guys here may not be able to define stress. And like somebody said to me last week, you don't have any reason for stress in your life. So I thought that, while I'm doing actually my job, I don't get stressed. But then there are other things which stress you out. So how to define stress? I think everybody has stress. Everybody has different reasons. And we often don't know that we are stressed and it's affecting us.
Excellent. Anything else? Any other questions?
Yeah, possibly partly the same, that every day we are facing so many pressures, small and little, and it's difficult to discern whether, you should categorize it as stress, and if it actually is stress and it, compiles many such small pressures compile into being stress eventually, then how to, minimize it maybe at that small level, and how if it becomes big to deal with it. And how to maybe help your children deal with stress if the onset is going to be at 14 of clinical depression.
Right.
So that.
Any other questions?
Anybody?
These are excellent questions. I think we've already got a few answers. But yeah.
Okay.
Maybe you could
take it. I think it's very important to be aware about your stress. Most of the time, we are not even aware that we are stressed. So if you are not aware, that part will never be addressed.
Right.
So if you don't address, you tend to live with it. I think it's very important to be aware what stress is and whether you are in stress or you're not.
Right. So basically, your question is, how do we become aware whether we are stressed or not?
Unconscious stress.
Hello.
Yes.
Varunji, I would like to know whether stress and fear, if a stress without fear, can it be called a stress?
Excellent question. Stress and fear access.
How to create a conducive atmosphere at home so that like my son is going to be in class 10th. So especially the next 3 years are going to be very critical. So how to create an atmosphere in which, the stress is reduced for him as well as for us.
Excellent.
Can unreasonable expectations because of stress, unreasonable expectations from different aspects, like parents, she rightly said at home, expecting too much from a child, he or she is not capable of giving. And when that expectation is not achieved, may cause stress at both levels. It was expected of me, I could not deliver. At the same time, we expect it could not be delivered to us.
We are all passing through stress. Some of it may be clinical, some may be fear. Say all these ultimately leads to depression. Light type of depression, serious depression. Now how do we handle all this? How do we de-stress ourselves? That would be my prime, objective of attending this session.
How could we de-stress?
When and how did stress begin?
Yes.
Possibly
Yeah, I think that will get covered in the defining. We have something on that.
Yeah, we're doing that. Is a stress, there are different types of stress. Is this all connected? Can I differentiate and isolate and address each other?
Different types of stress.
Yeah.
So my question was very similar to what you've said. I wanted to know, is there something like a good stress also?
Yes. Great question.
Varun, my question is a bit different.
Just one minute.
Yeah. Are we making too much fuss about stress?
Are we making too much fuss? Much ado about nothing, right? To quote Shakespeare, he has paid for people.
Yeah.
See the stress increase.
India is increasing.
Near the same area. Thanks.
Yes.
Yeah, in today's world, I feel it's not just age 14. Like if you see small children also now, they'll say, I don't have time. I want to do this or I'm tired. So even though they don't know the word stress, but it's actually stress which is playing a role, yeah, in different way. When we were small, we have not even heard of, like, even though we were inclined to reading, so this word we had not come across. But this stress word, I think all of us are facing every day. It's only that coping mechanism. Or you read a lot about stress, and even if you know it, like, it's the only that situation, how do you reduce it? So I think all those, it's covered.
Probably covered, probably not, and I think as we go through the next hour or so, we will probably be able to
either answer these questions directly or maybe give some pointers. One of my professors used to say that when intelligent people ask good questions, they already know the answers. So I'm pretty confident that a lot of these questions that you've posed, you already have answers to these. Maybe not well formulated, but there is the epicenter of an answer is probably already there. Just needs to probably come out. And what we'll try and do today is put some structure around it, and Vinay will share his own experiences, and perhaps then we can come up with something that works for each one of us. So let me just start, and this is the agenda that we have set out for today. We will once again introduce ourselves. Manish has given a very fulsome introduction already, so perhaps that's not necessary. But the point we'll try to make is that neither of us is an expert in stress management. I am a financial guy, and Vinay is an IT guy, but we don't have too much training in stress. So whatever we talk about today is really, we would like it to be interactive. We would like to learn as much from you as you learn from our discussion. We will try to define stress. We will try to talk about how stress affects us, and then how stress can be managed. And then, to answer Dipti, your question, is there something called positive stress? Can stress be beneficial for us? So, and it probably also addresses, Smriti, your question, are we making too much about stress? Actually, I already did the introductions, so all I'm trying to say is that let's keep it as interactive as possible, because we are not really experts. We are lay people. We'll just share our experiences and perhaps some structures that we've read up about, and then share your experiences. So, defining stress. Really, stress is defined as the body's response to a stressor, to a stressful situation. And when I say a stressful situation, it is nothing but a perceived threat. So somebody had this question about the relationship between fear and stress. The original stress was nothing but body's reaction to fear, a perception of threat, right? A carnivorous animal, a snake close to you, a person with a weapon trying to attack you. The body's response to that is stress. And there are multiple ways that the body responds to stress, but the two most important mechanisms are what is known as the ANS, the autonomic nervous system, which goes into action without really any clear advice from the brain. It just immediately reacts. And the other is an axis of multiple systems known as the hypothalamic, pituitary, adrenal axis. These are three different glands in the body that secrete certain hormones, and these three work in tandem in a stressful situation to basically prepare the body for action. What is known as the flight or fight response of the body. They activate that. And that really is how stress acts on the body. It releases a hormone called cortisol and another hormone called adrenaline. These hormones will increase your blood pressure, they will increase your heart rate, they will make you breathe faster, they will start making you sweat. And all of those things are important in order for the body to react fast and to respond to a perceived or real threat. The problem really is that, so in some ways, as you can imagine, these things are good for you to be able to deal with that immediate situation. The problem is that if this happens too frequently, then your body starts to get certain negative impacts, which are known as costs. And these can be things like, your immune system getting impaired, the digestive system getting impaired, body's inability to absorb nutrients, the circulatory system, arteries becoming constricted, stuff of that kind, chances of a heart attack or a stroke going up. So there are multiple negative impacts that stress has. In fact, we've got another slide on it which breaks down the impacts into two parts. There are physical costs, which basically mean weakens our immune system, so we become more susceptible to disease on a more frequent basis, causes hormonal imbalance, decreases nutrient absorption, breakdown of muscle protein, narrowing of arteries, and increase in blood sugar. It is actually a very frequent or a very important cause of death in the United States. And the reason I'm quoting United States figures is because data for the entire world is not available, but the US has this data. So it's the 15th leading cause of death in the US. But another very important impact is the emotional costs that stress imposes on us. What a lot of scientists have said is that exposure to continued stress actually results in rewiring of the brain. The way we react to different situations becomes different. We start thinking very narrowly, because in a situation of real stress, there is a need to think narrowly. You want to react fast. You don't have time to consider a lot of different alternatives. You just pick something that comes quickly. Now, if that narrow thinking continues to be there in our daily life, then our creativity will start getting impaired. Our productivity will start getting impaired. And that is exactly what happens. And besides that, our happiness, well-being gets impacted. We become asocial. The example Manish was giving about, him wanting to spend more time on WhatsApp rather than with his children is probably an example of just that. Reduces mental agility, concentration, etc. So lots of negative impacts. And we are straight away jumping into a few ideas on how to deal with stress. And once again, there's a disclaimer. Dealing with stress, there is no one-size-fits-all solution. What works for one may not work for another. But we are going to present a few tactical and strategic approaches. And Vinay is also going to share his own personal experiences. Please look at them, please consider them. And if they work for you, then you can apply them more frequently. So the first one is breathing slowly and deeply. Somebody says something to you, or you're sitting in office and you receive an email which is very badly worded and it's insulting and all that. What's your immediate reaction? It's to try and punch back, right? Send a stronger email than the guy has written. Make him feel that he should never try to even say anything to you in the future. But what I've realized is that actually aggravates the situation. It will not get done what you want to get done. On the other hand, it will only spoil your relationship with that other person. It will make you less effective within the organization. So perhaps a better thing to do is to take a deep breath, calm down, and then maybe send a response. And one of the best ways to take a deep breath or take a relaxing breath is to breathe with your diaphragm. In fact, maybe we can do a small exercise, right? Where you want to?
When Varun mentioned this slide, personally, my experience with this, I used to do a lot of pranayama, and the thing which really helped me during for stress management to calm me down was something known as Bhramari Om. I used to do, with the Baba Ramdev, we do the Anulom Vilom, we do Kapalbhati. But chanting Om with your diaphragm, I'd like to do a visual demonstration. What I do.
So, Bhramari Om, as Baba Ramdev said, and really helped me for stress management was essentially the whole aim of Bhramari Om is to not only the physical act, but to look within yourself as you breathe, right? So I shut off everything else. Symbolically, I close my eyes, I close my ears, I symbolically close my mind as well. I look inside and take a deep breath. So doing this 10 times in a day, you should feel the vibration in your chest, feel the vibration, look inside when you're breathing. Trust me, that greatly reduces my stress and gives me a sense of well-being. It helped me big time. Real time, apart from being in practice, but actually during inner stress, even if you're driving, trust me, if I'm really stressed out, I just start, if I chant the Om from the diaphragm, does reduce my stress, does, I can feel it just melt away from the system. Om has great, great powers.
Thanks, Vinay. And I think there's also a scientific explanation for deep breathing being beneficial to us and stress relieving. What happens is when we breathe with our diaphragm and we let it expand, it gives a bigger expansion to the lung cavity, right? So the lung is able to take a larger amount of oxygen inside. When it takes a larger amount of oxygen inside, it is able to introduce a larger amount of oxygen into the bloodstream. So now when the blood goes to different parts of the body, every ounce of blood carries a higher concentration of oxygen. It therefore needs lesser volume of blood to be pumped to different parts of the body to get the same level of oxygen. So your heart now needs to beat less fast. As a result, by breathing deeply for a minute or two, you are able to bring down your pulse rate, your heartbeat, your blood pressure, all of those things. And it clearly does de-stress you, right? So, this is one technique that certainly works.
Yeah, Varun, I have got a comment.
Sure.
Yes.
Okay, so I also started, doing the chanting bit of it probably about a month back or so.
Okay.
And though I knew of meditation and things like that, I thought, does it really work?
Okay.
So, what we do is generally we Google up, we find out, and what I figured out was what our ancestors have told us thousands of years back, chant Om, and even in the West, they think it's more related to religion rather than anything else. But what I figured out was, in our body, there is a very important nerve called the vagus nerve. Okay, people can go and look it up. Now, what the vagus nerve does, it goes across the your heartbeat, it controls various organs in the body. So sometimes, as somebody asked, can there be stress without fear? So because our minds are very plastic rather than elastic, so with elastic you stretch something, it comes back. When your mind is plastic, you stretch something, it doesn't come back. Right? So it is deformed. Now for it to get formed again, you need to do something. So coming back to the vagus nerve, there have been various studies in the West, which says if you hum, right, if you hum, then what they call is the vagal tone that comes down. And when the vagal tone comes down, that's when you have more control over your organs. So that is the reason why if you take any of the gurus, right, Ravi Shankar, Ramdev, Jaggi Vasudev, they have different types of chanting, but all of them involve the humming sound, ma. So though Om we believe is, you know, very spiritual, very religious, it's not the fact. The fact that when you hum, it automatically calms you down. And that's what I feel is one of the reasons for your body calming down.
Understood. So again, basically Om has more scientific basis than just religious. Thanks for sharing that. One other method to deal with stress is actually smiling. Right now, smiling comes naturally to us when we are in a relaxed state, right? But making the opposite work, right? When you're not relaxed, when you're in a stressful situation, just go to the washroom, look at the mirror and smile to yourself, right? It's the body convincing the mind that everything is okay and it works. So that's another way to deal with the stress. Vinay, can you just move to the next slide?
I guess just the way you have psychosomatic symptoms because of stress.
Yeah, it's
you can also de-stress with psychosoma.
Absolutely.
I would say.
Absolutely.
And then we also got a demonstration of it by Dr. Sadana and Munna Bhai. He would laugh every time he was.
Laughter therapy, absolutely. Vinay will do that, right? A demonstration of that. Okay, another technique is aromatherapy. And I think all of us would have experienced it. Use of certain aromas, like thyme, for example, eucalyptus, lavender, chamomile, all of these aromas actually sort of create or produce chemicals in our system, or the olfactory nerve produces certain responses, which brings us back to what is known as homeostasis. Basically, a stress response takes you away from homeostasis, and something like aromatherapy helps you come back to homeostasis. So this is something that is, again, advisable to deal with stress. There are people who suggest that you can carry a small quantity of aromas that you like on salt crystals with yourselves to your office, and you can use it in a stressful situation. It will help you de-stress quickly. Another of the tactical approaches. And this, you know, what is known as palming, just rub your hands vigorously, make them warm, and then put them, maybe, should we do it once? We have enough time. You'll have to take off your spectacles.
I have just addition to this exercise. You have to really do it very vigorously till it starts tingling.
Stinging.
Then slowly close your eyes and bring your hands close to each other like this. And try to feel a field between your hands that something is pain. Just like this, you feel that something is pain. That's the magnetic field that it creates.
Okay. And then you put it against your eyes?
Yeah. Then
after that?
So that is what the healing power is. You can feel that field energy between your eyes.
Okay.
Very clearly you can feel.
Okay. It's not just the warmth you're saying, there is that.
It is not field. It is that
electrical energy.
It's electromagnetic field of the body.
Okay.
And this is how it gets activated. And you can really feel the ball between your palms when you do it like this.
Okay.
Like
okay.
The magnetic field.
So whoever did it right now, do you think it was de-stressing? Yeah? Okay. Great.
try this multiple times at different levels. Don't bring it, don't touch the hands. Keep it, you know, somebody will get it very close, somebody will get it, but you will after some time start feeling a force that it's sometime attracting, sometime repelling.
Your hand. Okay.
And that is what the old way of diagnosis was, that they say, no, that they will touch and they see. People who are very sensitive, they can see where the depletion of the force is and they can transfer that force to kind of get the level back.
How long do you do this?
You rub your hands till they start tingling.
Do you rub
keep rubbing your hands till they start tingling.
No, then you bring your hands close, slowly, and then you feel the force between the
eyes.
Then you apply wherever you want to apply, that transfers that way. Just cut this.
Just like cat's scale.
Okay, I think a lot of us actually rely on caffeine to relieve stress, right? In fact, we actually do coffee and conversations also. So maybe you should make it Nariyal Pani and conversations. But the fact is that coffee is a stressor. It releases the stress hormones. When you consume coffee, it releases stress hormones in the body. So very frequent use of caffeine is actually going to increase stress in the body. Perhaps having it in moderation is still okay.
We name it coffee and conversation, but normally we have tea and conversations.
Yeah, tea also has caffeine.
Listen.
Okay, thanks. Thank you. So one should cut down on caffeine to the extent possible. I also realize that most of us are already addicted to caffeine. So if we try to cut down on caffeine, we will have those withdrawal symptoms, there will be headache, etc. So maybe you have to do a gradual cut down, you can't immediately cut it off. But that is something to be thoughtful of. If you are stressed, having another coffee will only make it worse. It will not improve it. Now this is a very interesting solution. Carbohydrate-rich food, sugars, burgers, cream, etc., releases oxytocin in the body, which is a reliever of stress. So therefore, in a stressful situation, people try to consume sugary foods, right? The problem, however, is that when you have sugary food, it increases your blood sugar level very quickly. And when the blood sugar level goes up, your pancreatic system releases a lot of insulin to bring the blood sugar level down. And generally what happens is the pancreas also overreact. So your blood sugar level comes down to below what it is, what it normally should be. So then therefore you have more craving to have sweet food. So it becomes a vicious cycle, keeps forcing you to have more and more food to bring yourself to homeostasis. So therefore, it does work, but you have to be very careful in applying this technique.
Because then you put on weight and then you're more stressed.
Extremely stressed, absolutely. Absolutely. Now this is a long-term solution for stress, exercise. It obviously releases a lot of stress-related hormones, reduces the level of stress. It also strengthens your body from inside. It will take away the long-term impacts of stress. You know, for example, hardening arteries, etc., will get to some extent reduced by doing exercise. And then, you know, after some amount of exercise, it will actually release oxytocin in the body, which is clearly a good thing for dealing with stress. Sir?
Is there walking included in exercise?
Sorry?
Is walking included in exercise?
Absolutely. Yeah, yeah.
Physical exercise.
Yeah. To everybody their own, for some people walking may not be good enough exercise. For other people it might be, you know, people who are bedridden, they start walking, it's great exercise for them. But in any case, it is much better than nothing.
Even dancing is a good exercise.
Swimming.
Any physical exercise.
And walking is actually a very, very good exercise. To my mind, it's probably better than, some people may disagree, but I think it's better than running, right?
It even has beautiful byproducts like jashan and coffee with coins.
Yes. Yeah, if we were running, we would never have come up with the idea, right? Okay, prayer, extremely strong stress reliever to my mind. And as they say, prayer doesn't affect God. Prayer affects you, the person who's praying, right? It'll strengthen you from inside. It'll make you more confident. And this is actually over a lot of studies in several different countries. Different people have carried out studies over a large number of people, over huge populations. And consistently, the results have said that people who are more religious, more spiritual, are also more confident
more calm and less stressed. So prayer is a very, very strong technique of dealing with stress. I'll pause here. I'll let Vinay share some of his experiences and then I'll come back with some strategic approaches.
Thank you, Manish.
Thank you, Varun.
Jatha, Manish, Varun, two of my dearest friends. So yeah, this was about a year back. A year back I really started knowing people in this community. And a couple of months back, as I was doing the morning walk, and I was discussing with Manish, I said, you know, I'm so thankful I'm here in this community. Gurdeep ji introduced Jashna, that has brought music into my life, that's a de-stressor. We walk regularly, we discuss, blah, blah, blah. And that is, these are my, you know, two beautiful things which are there in my life. And Manish said, what about coffee and conversations? Oh yes, yes, coffee and conversations as well. And that's when he reeled me in. So why don't you take a class on it? Or some class. I said, oh, I can't speak on this. But you talked about stress, right? You know, why didn't you talk of stress management? I said, oh yeah, that sounds good. But I'm not an expert on this. I said, no, this is, you know, we will rope in Varun as well. And so this is more towards my experiences in stress management. Okay, I'm not an expert. And the disclaimer I would say over here is, unlike, you know, this is done by experts, do not try it at home. This is done by non-experts. And if you do like it, do try it at home. So that's a slight different take on this. So what set me on the path of stress management? As Manish mentioned that, yes, I was consulting for the last 20 years. Certain events took place which really stressed me out. And one day, going to work, I had an event. I couldn't breathe. I had issues and was taken to the emergency room. This is all in Boston when I was working alone and family's out here. And I thought I was doing a great job, you know. I used to do Baba Ramta yoga. I used to eat what I used to do Kapalbhati. I used to do Anulom Vilom, eat right, multigreen, blah, 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 all this stuff. I said, hey, I'm doing a good job. And nothing will happen to me per se. But yes, there was always, you know, you're traveling, you are jumping between two continents. The fear was there. And so it happened that I was the emergency and realized, oh, I have blockages. And well, it was cleared out. And but yet, you know, that start the process of what do I, you know, what happened, why me, all those questions. Fine. So there was a very great initiator at the hospital. After the process took place and I was fine, there was a study. Peace initiated at the Mass General Hospital. What was peace? It was an acronym. Positive energy after a cardiac event. A 7-week voluntary course. So someone came to me and said, oh, Vinay, do you want to participate in this? And I said, okay, fine, I don't have anything else to do. I am by myself, so why not? And let me tell you, that was one of the nicest things. Where, yes, this surgery was successful, everything was successful. But once you come out of this, you are then at a very critical stage when you start, the mind starts wandering. So, what happened to me? Why I did this, I did that, you know, yet this, the fear, did the job, the doctor do a good job, and stuff like that. So this was a 7-week, you know, where you had to do an interaction. You went home, they gave you a folder, and you had to write down various steps over there. So in my process of application of stress management, as we go along, I will touch base on it. The biggest thing which helped me was gratitude. Okay, so this was, and this is a beautiful saying I saw, you know, gratitude turns what we have into enough and more. It turns denial into acceptance, chaos into order, confusion into clarity. It makes sense of past, brings peace for today, and creates a vision for tomorrow. It's a beautiful thing, and we want to really think we do need to be aware of what we are grateful for. And one of the main steps they said was, when you write down, what are you grateful for? So I started doing a analysis. What am I grateful for? Yes, I had this thing. Said, oh, first thing, I had access to great healthcare. Okay, I'm in one of the top cities in the world, one of the top hospitals. There was somebody that would take me to the hospital. And when I spoke to the doctor after the procedure, you know, what happened, what's the prognosis? He said, Vinay, if you had $1 million, you probably lost 1 cent. I said, wow, thank you so much. So, because as you know, with a cardiac event, you can lose, even though you have been treated, you could have a loss of muscle. So then what else are you grateful for? So we can list down many things. So this is definitely, you know, in any type of a stressful situation, you do want to take one step backwards and analyze it and say, what am I grateful for? So if you can switch a stressful situation, give it a spin, literally give it a spin, and say, yes, this bad thing did happen, but in the end, in the profit loss situation, I'm still in profit. So it's up to you to generate a profit or generate a loss. It's totally in your hands. So gratitude is one of the biggest. Now, what are the reasons? Here we have a slide that says hitting our target. We look at a person with the corporate, he's trying to hit his target. What is the first thing you see out here? His muscles are taut, he's tight, he's focusing. I want to hit my target. So this itself is what we do on a regular basis. We are at all times trying to hit a target. And we are always looking at the end result. We are not looking at the way the arrow goes, what we are doing. We are always focusing on the end result. In the process of that, we tend to overreach ourselves. Now take the case in my case, what happened to the target? So as Manish mentioned, that I was consulting. Yes, I was in the States for around 20 years. I came back, and 2009 I moved back here. And 2011 I had a decision to take. Do I work here or I go back to the States? My family is out here. I said, okay, fine. I was never working 4 to 5 months in a year. Okay, there's always, you know, 1 meter with commission down there. So I had a choice. So do I take up a job here or do I go back to the US? My family's out here. And I can work there. I work 4 to 5 months, dollar income, man, enough. I'll, you know, come back. 4 mahina kaam karo, 8 mahina aaram karo, sort of things. This is what you start off with. So I got a good project, flew to Boston, and then I said, okay, my target was, despite me being in the US and my family being here, I should, you know, work in such a way that my family should not feel that I should be out of the country. So I actually kept a spreadsheet. Trust me on this. Every year I had a spreadsheet on my flights back and forth. I had a target that 5 months in a year I will be here in the US, come what may. This was my target. And started off, okay, first 3 months I went. Obviously, you can't tell that to the client and he'll just next day or in the next flight home, right? This was my personal target. So you start off, of course, you start off thinking you're going for a 3 month project, just get extended. Then you rework your strategies and you say, fine, I'll keep this target. I pre-booked my tickets back. So 2 months in Boston, 2 weeks back here, fly back again, And each time, so here I have put a target, I have put pressure on myself. Did somebody ask me to do this? No. It was a target I put on myself to, for whatever reason, right? And in trying to make this possible, it really put tremendous stress on me. And we'll go forward and see, you know, as we, how to achieve this, you know, you're working in two zones, you're trying to balance. So that was one target which I had, which really, I think, was one of the reasons which caused me my. So as the Gita saying, karmanyavadikaraste mahafaleshu, whatever. So it is, the basic crust is that, you know, try to just do not, it's not that don't keep a target. Enjoy the process. Like we say, do things in moderation. It's not that you don't need to have, everybody needs to have a target, but let now that be an obsession. And don't put unnecessary stress on yourself by placing unreachable targets. Dil pe mat le yaar. This is something really, again, personally I felt out here. We go ahead, we start putting 120% into everything we do. And take this, you know, you have projects and you put in 80, 100 hours, and at the end of it, there are two things, either success or failure. And trust me, it's not just failure which can bring you stress. Sometimes even success, because you then there's an expectation of appreciation and expectation of, you know, I put in all this work. So it's not personal, right? Whatever you do, enjoy the journey, put in the effort, but don't put in so much effort that it becomes personal and the result of that path turns into stress and dilpe. So dilpe definitely mat le yaar. And it could be more even from, you know, it's not just it's from corporate perspective. You know, you put 120% the effort into your kid and they say, I did this, I did that, and you, there's expectation of a result. And then there is, so it's not personal. Definitely in my case was, yes, I had three or four excellent implementations, put in 120%, and then felt, oh man, I didn't get the appreciation or rather. So it is not personal. Nothing in life is personal. It's not worth taking to heart. And if you do, your heart becomes. Next. This is one thing, you know, we do want to, which everybody is aware, the serenity prayer, all right? We do want to be aware of this on a day-to-day basis, and we do want to have a reality check on, we give me the strength to accept things I cannot change, the courage to change things that I can, and the wisdom to know the difference. So on a day-to-day basis, each time a stressful situation comes to your doorstep, try and categorize it. First of all, and in terms of a layman, financial terms, is there an ROI, right? If there is no return, it's not worth putting the stress. And trust me, there's nothing in the world which will give you a return which, you know, ultimately puts you, makes you horizontal, right? So put in the effort. And in all these steps, you know, we do want to have a target. We do want to do, but everything has to be within the limits, in moderation. Put in the efforts in moderation, and you have to have an ROI on everything you do. Is it worth the stress? Is it worth it? To what end can I put in my efforts wherein I will be so affected by the end results that I hurt myself? The biggest part of the hum, we have these saying, the song, right? Humko man ki shakti dena, man vijay kare. Dusron ki jay se pehle, khud ko jay kare, right? This is extremely important. I mean, I felt in here, and we start putting in so much efforts, we are the last in the line. So it's not selfish to love yourself. take care of yourself and to make your happiness the priority. It is necessary. It's like this car out here. You're taking this much stress. You are the one carrying your family. You are the one carrying your project. You are carrying ones. Don't be in the such a stress that it is broken down. So, respecting oneself is absolutely prime. You owe it to your family. You owe it to your job. You owe it to your success. Work-life balance. So we always keep here talking about work-life families, work-family, right? I look at this slide and say, hey, this is missing something. Instead of dichotomy, it should be a three, wherein it should be work, family, and self, right? So that's where the balance should be. You are still carrying. You're carrying a large load. You have all these people depend on you in your company, in your family life, in your friends. And it's up to you. You are the driver. Make sure, of course, you have somewhere to see. Some your windshield is not blocked. And you can carry it in the right direction. Respecting oneself. Always, you know, stand there, I give. And you kids, you people, you know, have no respect.
I have a little something to add here, if you don't mind. And it is possibly a cue from what Varun was also saying, that when you look in the mirror and you smile, you're making yourself smile thing. Also, it's about how we wire our mind.
Absolutely.
And you do not have to look at your family as a burden, or you do not have to look at your family as a cause of stress that you're balancing out. It's important. In fact, family, I would say in your slide of the things that de-stress, ways of de-stressing, I think one of the biggest de-stressors is your family.
Absolutely.
Should bond with them, you should talk to them.
True.
And wire your brain into not thinking that family is another
pile of people
you are carrying and burdening.
No, you try to do things to your... It's absolutely not a burden. So your work is also not a burden, right? You enjoy your work, you enjoy this, you enjoy family. But when you start to, in the process of doing things, let it not be turned into a stressor, right?
Sure.
So that's why everything has to be in one. The key thing out here, each and everything I say, it's not like don't do this. You absolutely have to do it, right? You have to have a target. You have to have a work-life balance. And everything, it's that when you go beyond moderation and go to the other side, that's when it becomes a stressor. So each and everything is not like, don't do this. Hey, you have to do it. There's no way about it, right? You have to do each and everything in the slide is something you absolutely have to do.
I think what you mean is we should not get obsessed by...
Absolute target obsession. Target obsession. Key things. That's obsession of the target where we go beyond our moderation, right? Even water. Simple thing is water, which is, you know, you drink too much water, you can get water poisoning, right? You take... my doctor said, hey, Vinay, you can have a couple of drinks. No problem. That's not the problem. The problem is when you start obsessing with it.
Yeah, that also
right?
You missed. You just talked about caffeine and coffee.
Yeah.
You mentioned about drinks. A lot of people take drinks.
No, it is. And
that is strategic.
Yeah, it is. Okay. Share the stress. Share the stress. Share your problems. Definitely, when you are in a stressful situation, you do want to share your stress. You do want to, and in that, you know, Manishji, Varunji keeps saying about prayer, right? I would say prayer also is one way you share your stress, right? It is where you say, okay, ab tumhare hawale, right? You don't just chant, you want to go ahead and say, yes, this is what is my problem. You talk to God and you say, yes, I'm sharing, and you just...
I have a very different thought on this. Again, I feel, you know, when we say, when we're talking to God and when we're praying,
it's basically we are changing our own chemical structure. When we are spraying, we are only focusing on the positive. We forget every negative when we pray.
Mm-hmm.
So more than a religious thing, it's much more of a spiritual thing where we completely put aside our negatives with complete and utter faith. We pray and we only initiate the positive in our body.
Absolutely. And it's like one of, it's like saying ab tumhare hawale watan sathiyo, ab tumhare hawale, right? So you say, what if you're transferring the stress, you're sharing the stress.
Absolutely.
And you are sharing, even like in a situation like, you take the simple thing, it's really stupid, right? Okay, I'm having a complex problem, an algorithm, and I'm trying to, it's not working, right? I struggle. And I then call a friend and say, hey guy, come sit beside me. Just sit beside me. And I start explaining to him the problem. And trust me, 9 times out of 10, before he can give me the solution, I get the solution. We call it as a dummy programmer. So same thing as far as stress goes, you know, rather than unburden, you can unburden to your loved ones. Obviously, you can't just pick anybody and start unburdening. So, but yes, you do want to stress. And in the case of, in terms of the equation, you're increasing the surface area, right?
Yeah.
So that way, it is a share your stress, share your problems. It definitely helps. Positive social interaction, positive energy. I mean, yes, definitely coffee and conversations, just, you know, these are all places where you can draw on positive energy. You go to singing classes, you meet friends, you meet people which common. So man is a social animal. The more you network, the more you meet people with your, you know, who are wield positive influence, a great stress reducer. One of the movies which everybody is aware of, Anand, right? In that, the one of the dialogues which really hit me hard, you know, Vamashai, jante ho, hum aane wale gham ke baare mein soch ke, aaj ki khushi mein zeher ghol lete hain. So this is so, so hard hitting in terms of where, this is another, the saying which, you know, the gift, yesterday is history, tomorrow a mystery, today is a gift, and that is why it's called the present, right? So you do want to, and in this case, you know, about 4 months back, my mom was in the ICU, and 3 months out of the hospital, she was extremely critical, on the ventilator for like 4 weeks. And during that period of time, we had Jashna. We had also one program by our Chintamani sir that we had out here, and I was there at the ICU. And the doctors were taking care, I was upset, blah, blah, blah. But then I had a choice. Do I need to come here? Or do it? I was parked there for 3 months. So I took a choice. No, let me come here. Right? Today, she is fine. The doctors are taking care of her. I will come here. I'll sing a song. And I'll go back. And mom has recovered perfectly. So we start thinking so negatively about the future. And already start, you know, what do you say, bemoaning and start before the tragedy comes. So stay in the present. Attitude is everything. Now here is one of the slide, you know, it's, well, the saying is, everybody knows, attitude is everything in life. It's life is 10% what happens to you, 90% how you react to it. We go on long drives, or we have a child, right? And the child is irritated, we give a rattle. We put something on the car seat, and that basically, what does that do? That distracts the child, right? It distracts the child, and the child is not stressed out. Okay, let's apply the same thing to ourselves. Today I commute to, you know, whenever I'm in a traffic situation. I have, from our classes, we have a Riyaz. I just plug that in and I start doing my Riyaz. They're in traffic. So I basically, it really helps me out. Wherein I'm not affected by the traffic, I'm stuck in the traffic, I have a red signal, and I'm doing my Riyaz. So I have basically changed my attitude, I've distracted myself, just as a child. You distract it with a rattle, distract yourself with something else. And that really helps you take your mind off that stressful situation and helps you cope with it. And I love that. If half an hour becomes 1 hour, hey, I have 1 hour, yes, no problem. I move on. So it is. It helps me out. Attitude is absolutely everything. Reality check, right? So one of the things, main things in gratitude was definitely a reality check, right? Positive comparison. I said, oh, why me? Why did I have this blockage? Why did I have, this? I took care of myself, blah, 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 blah. So in the process of doing gratitude, you have to do a positive comparison. Hey, did something bad happen? Yes, it was destined to happen. Did I come out of it? Yes, I did come out. I'm still standing. As I said, count your blessings, wrote down everything out there. What is the positive comparison? And that absolutely helped. In this, there was one very nice incident. There was a World Cup final between South Africa and Australia. And Lance Klusener, he's the top all-rounder, absolute top all-rounder. He's won many matches for South Africa. And Australia were like 7 or 8 wickets down. And Steve Waugh was the last recognized batsman. He plays the ball to mid-on. Lance Klusener has to take that catch. He takes the catch and celebrates before gaining control, right? And the catch is deemed dropped. And South Africa from that lose the World Cup because of that one drop. And Steve Waugh comes up to him. Hey mate, you just dropped the World Cup. And the world is screaming at him, like you. He was the top all-rounder. And his reply, when people ask him, okay, how did you deal with it, with so much criticism, just 2 words, he said, nobody died. So that's, wow. Yes, nobody died, right? Let it move on. So if you start fretting, positive comparison, it's not, yes, did you put in the effort? Yes, I put in the effort. Have I done my due diligence? I have done. Mistakes happen. So nobody died. So it can be applied in many things, right? To my case, I didn't die, I'm still vertical, blah, blah. Ultimate comparison, right? That was magnificent. And last but not the least, truly, do not delete, the world stops without you. You go on thinking, hey, with me, this project is going to be, I'm the one driving this, I'm the one, having to, without me, nothing can go. I micromanage, I yell, I do this, it's all I. You are not Atlas, right? You are not Atlas, do not believe the world stops. Subha Kalvi, the sun will still rise. And of course, definitely, two small things, give back to society, try to do charity work, work with the less privileged, very important. Watch comedy once a day, absolutely important. This was one of the steps. Half an hour, watch comedy. Dil khol ke haso, there's no service tax on it, right? Laugh, watch half an hour a day, make it a point to watch comedy.
GST will also not
be there. Nothing will be there. No good service tax, no general service tax. And this was very important. Before the end of the day, watch half an hour of comedy, laugh, and that does help. And in the last, of course, there's one song which, if I have your permission, which really loves me, I really love it. We did sing this earlier. मैं जिंदगी का साथ निभाता चला गया हर जिंदगी का साथ निभाता चला गया हर फिक्र को धुएं में उड़ाता चला गया हर फिक्र को धुएं में उड़ा बर्बादियों का सोध मनाना फजूल था बर्बादियों का सोध मनाना फजूल था मनाना फजूल था बर्बादियों का जश्न मनाता चला गया, बर्बादियों का जश्न मनाता चला गया, जो मिल गया उसी को मुकद्दर समझ लिया, जो मिल गया उसी को मुकद्दर समझ लिया, मुकद्दर समझ लिया, जो खो गया मैं उसको भुलाता चला गया, जो खो गया मैं उसको भुलाता चला गया, मैं जिंदगी का साथ निभाता चला गया। थैंक्स विनय। विनय ये देना, विनय आई थिंक आफ्टर दैट वंडरफुल सॉन्ग देयर इज वेरी लिटिल लेफ्ट टू से राइट बट आई हैव you know, a small approach that I read upon somewhere and I thought I'll share with you, perhaps tries to put things in some kind of structure, and I'm a guy who likes structure. So just dealing with the different problems that one has, there are four different approaches that can be adopted. One is to avoid certain things. If you're not able to avoid them, try to alter them, try to change them a little bit. If also that doesn't work, then adapt yourself, change yourself a little bit to manage that situation, and if even that doesn't work, then accept the situation, learn to live with it. And that these four things, if you do, they should help you deal with a lot of stress. I'll just give you some examples. Avoiding stress, now that is something that I'm very good at. I mean, that's something, my stress relief mechanism is to avoid, but I realize that you can't do that always. However, there are still a few things that can easily be avoided. For example, sometimes it is okay to say no. I mean, a lot of us just don't like to do that. I mean, whether it's a project in the office, whether it is, you know, somebody saying that they're you've invited to a certain event that you really don't want to go to, but you can't say no, you can say no, right? It's much better to say no, say it politely, say it with empathy, but believe you me, it's much better to say no than to land up and add stress to yourself. Avoid people who stress you out. And also this paring down the to-do list. And there's a lot of stress, at least to me personally, that comes from having these 15 or 20 bills that I have to pay every month. The credit card bill, the electricity bill, the telephone bill, you know, four or five telephone bills. My daughters now have telephones and I have to pay those bills also. It adds to stress, I tell you not. And one of the things I've done is just automated that, and that just makes life easier. Very small thing just reduces the level of stress a little bit. Altering the situation. Now, in certain instances, we just take stress or we probably perceive stress. We think that a coworker does not like us. We think that our boss is not favoring us. And we just become very stressed about any communication we receive from that person. But sometimes it's better to just have a word with them, to express yourself, to figure out if that is really what the situation is, rather than creating that perception in our minds. That requires a little bit of communication. It may even require a little bit of compromise, but this does help to reduce the situation. So try to alter the situation a little bit. For example, one of the ways of dealing with this could be, you know, just if there's a job that you're working in that is giving you too much stress, leave that job. You can afford to do that. It's not all that impossible to quit. You can find a much better job. You can find a much better set of co-workers to work with. Adapting to the stressor, and this is very similar to what Vinay just mentioned. Look at the situation in a more positive light. Look at the big picture, reframe the problem. I think the example that he gave of being in traffic for a longer time and actually using that time to do something that he enjoys doing. So he doesn't mind being in traffic now. He probably enjoys it. If it's not half an hour and becomes 1 hour, he actually thinks it's better. So that's the way of reframing the problem and actually minimizing a stress-inducing situation. Looking at the big picture, that balance sheet that he's talking about, the positives and negatives, think about all the positives you have in your life, and then the negatives will start to appear a little bit smaller. Adjusting your standards. I think a lot of us are perfectionists.
But there is a time when we cannot achieve that perfection, and especially when we start delegating, right? If you want to grow in an organization, you cannot be an individual contributor. You have to be able to manage a team. And while managing a team, if you want each one of your team members to perform to perfection, I can assure you, you are not a great team leader. You have to accept some level of less than perfect output. Only then you can be a great team leader. Only then can you create good organizations. You have to accept that. So therefore, adjusting your standards and practicing gratitude, I think Vinay gave some lovely examples around that. I don't have to belabor the point. Finally, accepting the things that you can't change. I mean, you live in India, there are certain things you have to live with, right? So, you're a world citizen, and you know the world is creating a lot of stress today. There is nothing you can do about it. And perhaps in those situations, don't try to do anything about it, right? Just accept it. Look for the upside, learn to forgive. There will be certain relations who do certain things in a way that continues to hurt you. Learn to forgive, move on. Don't keep it bottled up inside you. And finally, share your feelings, right? Your family, as Deepa was pointing out, and as Vinay also said, your family is a very, very important stress reliever. Share your feelings with them, and that will help break down stress. I think these are a few stress relieving mechanisms that can be done. One is at a micro level. At short intervals, you can do these things, you know, meditation perhaps, talking to a loved one. And this is something that I've started practicing now. Lunch in the office, I leave my phone away. I don't allow it to disturb me during lunch. I don't have a lot of time, 15-20 minutes, but at least those 15-20 minutes, I ensure that I'm not bothered by my phone. Taking one or two days off in a week is a good idea. Sometimes it's okay to, you know, work the weekend, but don't do it again and again and again. That certainly starts to harm you. Pursuing hobbies, going shopping, excellent ideas to de-stress yourself. One should do that on a frequent basis. Don't go with your wife. Go shopping.
Are we to assume this session is only for men?
No, no. Women should go shopping. Men should go shopping.
Separate.
Should be. Sir. Good
evening. Everybody is very
good. So they accept it. And they call the student.
And adopt it.
It is very easy to absorb the stress, you know.
Right.
In the office, you have got a lot of stress.
Correct.
When you reach home, there is a different type of stress. Environment pays different type of stress.
Correct.
What is the common formula for relieving this type of stress? There is no stress. Yes, life is very complex.
Correct.
Every state, when you come down from the 11th floor, you talk to watchman, there is no water, stress.
Stress.
When you go to garden, somebody is going to do this thing, again stress.
Correct.
Family, lot of stress. Office, lot of stress.
Right.
You said you have to calm down and accept the situation. Excellent. Then you will be remaining in the same position throughout the year. Well, life will remain the same position. If you don't reply immediately to the person,
correct,
as you say,
correct,
if somebody is frightened at your end, then you should calm down.
Right.
Then you are all the time suppressed. Then how will you come up?
No.
You get promotion, you will not get increment, you never get position.
Correct.
So it is very easy to define, to relieve the stress.
Right.
Then wo bolega to mama hi hai. You say it, you laugh, you smile.
Correct.
Yeah? Only Rahul Gandhi can do that.
No, I agree. And in fact, somebody also had this question, is that all stress bad? And, you know, I'm coming to that section of our discussion today, which says that can stress be beneficial, right? And that is what we're going to talk about. Again, a very brief discussion. There was a study conducted, once again, I'm using a US study for lack of data from elsewhere,
A study conducted over 30,000 participants. This was an 8-year study. And there were two questions asked of the people. How much stress have you experienced in the last year? And then, do you believe that stress is harmful for your health?
Okay. Should we do that? Here was the assessment again, ask people to raise hands.
Yeah, good idea, good idea. So how many of you have experienced stress in the last year? High levels of stress.
High levels
of
stress.
High levels. So,
hath khada kar sakte
hai na? Okay, so about 30% of the population here.
100%.
Same level of stress, for some it is this and some it is this.
Correct.
It's not quantified.
What is high level? Your own perception. If you think it was high, it was high. Your definition, own definition. Okay, now this question. Do you believe stress is harmful for you?
Of course, yes.
Yeah, just raise hands.
Again, in varying degrees.
Not
how much stress?
Again,
okay, fair enough. So again, this question was asked. And let's see what the results were. Then they used public records to figure out how many people died, what proportion of people died and all that. And these are the results. People who experienced a lot of stress in the previous year were 43% more likely to die than people who did not experience a very high level, people who experienced a moderate level of stress. The interesting thing is that people who experienced a high level of stress but did not believe that stress was harmful for them, they did not have any extra mortality compared to the control group. So it's all in the mind. Coming back to what Smriti said in the beginning, is this much ado about nothing? If we know that stress is not bad for us, perhaps it is not bad for us. If we know how to deal with stress, perhaps stress can be beneficial.
There is probably no stress at all.
Maybe. Maybe it will require a different definition. But today's definition of stress, that release of cortisol in the body, that release of adrenaline in the body, if that is how we define stress, then that is happening to us. It is just that we do not know how to deal with it, or we think too negatively about it. And that therefore, so we think negatively about it, but we don't do too much about it. That harms us. So your question.
Just one more.
Sorry, earlier statistic was saying stress is the 15th largest killer in the US.
Right.
And here you're saying that 43% people said that they did experience a lot of stress.
No, no, no. What I said was, there was a certain percentage of people who experienced higher stress.
Correct.
And if the proportion of those people who died was 43% higher than the proportion of people who died in the group where there was moderate stress.
Correct. But if 15% of the 15th largest killer, that obviously is people who had a high level of stress, right? It could not be moderate stress that killed them.
Correct.
So then obviously those 15, like 15th largest killing reason in America is people who were highly stressed. They also knew that it was harming their bodies.
Right.
And their life and affecting them. So this study is very conflicting. It cannot be possible that 0% were affected by it.
This is...
I just came back from America. I was living there for 3 years.
Right.
And I understand the stress.
Right.
And the reasons of stress might be slightly different, but human life is human life. It's similar.
Right.
Suffering and joy is pretty similar. And there are different kinds of reasons for people to have stress in America versus what we have here.
Okay.
But this study is kind of conflicting because on one hand, we all agree that stress is a killer. But if we just accept that stress does not harm me, it's not going to stop harming me, right?
Okay, okay.
So if you're saying you're just going to like train your mind to think that I can go unlimited amount of stress, but it's not going to harm me, I'm not going to be at any risk, then
okay,
that's not believable.
Okay. Now I understand your question. Manish, you want to address that?
No. Yeah, so it's the same study. So you look at it as two ways. There are people who experience a lot of stress, right, in the previous year, there is ends. Now you isolate those people and look at death records to see how many people died. Obviously, people who experience a lot of stress, they have 43% higher risk of dying. But with a caveat, it's not all of them. out of those, there is a section of people who believe stress is harmful. In fact, majority of people who experience high stress believe stress is harmful. And it's in there, in that population, that there's a 43% higher risk of dying. In people who experience high stress but believe stress is a friend and not an enemy, that the death rates actually are at the same level as people who experience moderate to low stress. And their mindset works as follows. So for example, if I have to address you, public speaking is the most stressful situation in the world. People prefer dying to public address. You know, they say, let me kill myself, but I will not come and address like this, you know, addressing public. Now, if I have an option, for example, Varun and Vinay, when we discussed that they should come and talk about it, they had the option to run away and say, look, this is very stressful. I don't want to address, I'm not available, I don't know anything about the subject, whatever. They want to run away from the stress. Or they say, this is good stress to get, it's high stress. Because the most, it's the toughest job in the world, after relationships, after managing relationships. But I want to accept the challenge. Now what you do is you say, but this, I'm getting stressed, I'm getting butter in my stomach, my heart rate has gone up, I'm sweating, whatever. But I'm saying, this is telling me that I have never done enough public speaking. Maybe this topic is not familiar with me. So let me do one thing. Let me first practice public speaking. Let me practice the subject. Let me know more about it and gain confidence. So what I'm saying is that high stress, but how do you approach it? Did you run away from it? No. I said I will not run away, but I will confront it, convert my anxiety or stress into action, into achievement. That is when it becomes beneficial. Then those people don't die. But people continue to believe that stress, high stress is harmful to them. They run away from situations. Those are people who die.
Babish, I would like to add on to that. Yeah,
I agree to what you're saying, that if you can condition yourself to think that this is not harmful for me, then obviously you prepare for it. But public speaking is not an everyday thing for people who get stressed by it. You ask Russell Peters.
That's just an example.
Yeah.
So that's just an example.
As an example, I'm saying that Russell Peters, it's a profession, right, for Russell Peters. For him, he enjoys being on stage. For him, that's not stressful. So what are these people getting affected by on a day-to-day basis is not some exceptional, thing that they're doing. It's the regular day-to-day stuff that is getting them stressed out. It's not that fear of the unknown. It's not like I have to suddenly play a game of tennis with Roger Federer, and that is going to stress me out, and that's how I, you know, end up killing myself. The problem is that a lot of stress that these people who die from this stress is something that they cannot avoid, and they cannot ignore. It's piled on their lives, and they have no way of escaping it. So no amount of preparation can prepare you to think that this is going to go away if I just try and weave my way through it.
Just a small example, and I'm not even sure if it's going to, it's worth saying. When a child starts to go to school, first time, is crying, is throwing up, is stressed, because it's going to eventually become a day-to-day thing. But the child is so stressed, the parents have to literally sit outside, and the child is going to cry his wits out, or her wits out. But eventually, the child will do, in a subconscious manner, the four A's, I would say, and eventually will try to adapt and then eventually accept that every day at this time I will have to go to school, and stops crying, stops resenting, and that doesn't become stress anymore. What it was, but even a child subconsciously, by doing the day-to-day thing, stops being stressed because they have accepted, they have adapted, and it's not stress anymore. I don't know, maybe it may
I
not
agree.
Be even applicable.
I agree.
These people who are doing these studies are people who are the highest stressed people in America would be people working on Wall Street.
Those people have been working on Wall Street for 20 years. They are people who are in high stress environments,
right,
dealing with billions of dollars,
right,
on a day-to-day basis. It's not like they're going to school first day.
Right.
They've been there, and that stress accumulates in their life and builds on to a level where it starts affecting them psychosomatically.
Correct.
It's not like a new thing that has been thrown into their face. They are doing this day in and day out. After a point, it starts affecting them.
Yeah.
So what's the point?
Okay. So my point is that it's not that by just thinking that this stress is not going to harm, I'm going to get away from the impact of that stress.
You have to stop looking.
You have to figure out a way of how to relieve your stress. You just can't, it's not a mind game. This 0% doesn't work for me. That's what I mean.
Okay, I mean,
sure.
It's
okay. So if you're to reject the study, that's okay.
The point is, this is only one of the ways of managing stress.
I'm sure it works for some people.
Absolutely. So, you know, as I've been articulating, there are a lot of ways of managing stress, and this is probably just one way of training your mind. And maybe at the cusp of highly stressful and the medium stressful, maybe there are some cases where you can actually fall, you know, reduce your stress levels. But you're absolutely right. One size does not fit all.
Yeah, absolutely.
Has there been any studies wherein some figure is there that stress is beneficial? Has there been any studies on that as well?
I mean, basically, this study says that stress is not. Stress is not as harmful as we think it is, okay, if we know how to deal with it.
But I let me tell you, experience also, I have experienced stress. Now let me tell you, this is an
experience I have seen in many of my 20s and in myself also. Stress is something which brings in best from you.
Yeah,
is something which brings in best with you, otherwise
absolutely.
It remains latent forever.
Absolutely. Absolutely.
This is a fact.
This study happens.
This is a fact.
That's good. Yeah.
Yeah, for example, let me tell you, when you said you are in US, some situation arrives because sometimes domestic, social, work, or this kind of situation, that certainly brings in some environment which stresses you. To find a solution to that stress, something which brings best out of you.
Yeah.
And you overcome stress. And you learn more, which otherwise would have remained latent forever in your life.
You know, one thing, just to my two cents out here.
Can I just one second?
As far as when you're talking about stress, you know, working stress. Trust me, I felt the least stressed when I had a good days at work. And the day, you know, if you are there's no work, or there's something that you're waiting for something. At the end of the day, I was extremely stressed. So good stress, definitely you have to work. Just like I just say, friction. Friction is required, without which there is no movement, right? So you need to have stress, you need to work, you need to work hard. It's how you adapt to it, right? And as we are talking of everything in moderation, each and every experience which I mentioned is absolutely required. Family is required, work is required, play hard, work hard, do everything. It's when you have to be aware, right? So my case, I felt that, you know, there is something wrong with me, right? So, and I have to work, right? There's no point. I had kept a target. I have to keep flying in, flying out. I was taking the Sunday night flight, flying 16 hours, getting off in New Jersey, you know, changing and going directly to work. I had kept a target. And I could have done it in a different way. I could have flown on a Saturday, but I had kept a target. Yes, I want to do this. At the same time, I was aware that, okay, there's something might be wrong. So every year I used to do a complete executive health checkup. I used to go to and get a stress test, 2D, blah, 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 everything. Apart from all these things, I said, you know, what else can I do? I kept a bottle of aspirin with me. So I did not let that stress, you know, put me down. I said, okay, fine, what else can I do, right? I kept aspirin with me. Trust me, when I went, I was walking up the stairs, went to work. And that morning I had exercise also, and I just couldn't breathe. Boom, took the aspirin, 5 aspirin just popped in. So being aware is the critical part. Being, doing things in moderation, being aware of a stressful situation, you can then come out of it in a positive way. So that's about also, I think over here we're talking of people is everybody has stress. It's how you approach to it. How you can reframe it, how you cannot avoid stress. I mean, we are living, be it US, be it India, wherever. Trust me, I was more stressed out here. People say, oh, you come from the family and you come down for a vacation. I said, no, man, I'm more stressed because I'm juggling three, you know, daytime, taking the kids here, taking, you know, out, meeting friends and taking care of bank work. And 5 o'clock, I have to open up my laptop, 5 to 1 a.m. I have to work. And I have to do that, you know, I am a consultant, I have come here not on a vacation. Morning I have to get up, check my mails, then rush here. It was around the clock. I had also, you know, the time zone change. Every 2 months I was like boom, boom, here and there. So I was generating stress on myself. because I was not doing things in moderation. Right? The same thing could have been handled in a much better way. But I set myself a target, and then I probably moved from, I almost moved to a place where I could have been in the 0% where, you know. So being, you have, everybody has stress. Everybody has stress.
Definitely stress is different for everybody.
Yeah, yeah.
It's a very personal.
Yeah.
You don't know whether you had a set question.
Yeah, it's, yeah, I just say, we have to, the studies are there, we,
actually, just,
all these studies are there where we can take the positives out of it. And
I think this has generated a lot of debate, and I think that's a good thing.
Yeah.
I think all the time I was getting a feeling that we are talking about stressors which are outside us.
Right.
And as if time management, stress management, we want to manage them. I think one thing that we need to understand is our immediate environment is not the external environment, but our mind itself. So according to me, stress is more a mind game.
Yes.
And then how you deal with the mind itself will throw different ways of managing stress. Than saying, how do you manage family stress? How do you manage work stress? What do you do? You know, these are good as tips.
Yes.
But basically, the realization has to be that my immediate environment is my mind itself. And the stress is in the mind rather than in the outside world. Especially when we are talking about the modern world. I can understand, I think, Varun, I think, talked about, started saying, it is a body's reaction. Stress is a body's reaction. Now, it was okay in the old days when people were being chased by tigers, etc. Today, you have tigers in the form of various things. Your bosses, your wives, or whatever. You know? And they are going to be with you forever. So, actually, the stress is in the mind rather than anywhere else. And how do we manage? And there's one more point I want to make, actually, which may be a little controversial point. That stress is never there in the present moment. Stress is always a function of past.
Absolutely.
Or future. Past because we start worrying, how could I have changed this? What would have happened if this would have changed? That creates a lot of, trying to change the past itself is a big stress. Future, we know fears. And the biggest fear is the fear of death, which is a subconscious fear. And those also play a big role in the stress management. So I think this is it's all about the mind game. That's what I want to say. Thank you.
Yeah. Very nice. I think last two, then.
Okay, I will keep it very short. I don't want to stretch it. But I think when we talk about stress, I think, you know, we when we move and do this discussion, I think, you know, we cross the boundary and we don't stay on the stress track. I think we're talking about difficulties, sadness, you know, all those other things but stress. And, you know, I hear example of, it sounds like a challenge. It sounds like challenge or something that you want to do, accomplish a difficulty, overcome something. But, you know, stress is something, you know, when you talk about these studies and high amount of stress, you know, we're talking about divorces, we're talking about depression, we're talking about somebody, a high debt. We're talking about a stress situation where, you know, the bankers are after you or you might get killed. You know, these are the extreme situation where, you know, the requirement of stress management is, you know, it's you know, you want how to deal with those situations rather than how to catch a plane or how to, you know, accomplish several emails. These are the difficulties day-to-day life, which when a person gets into that situation, he definitely will solve it because, you know, he has reached to that position. I don't think so. That is a stress, or that could be a good stress, or in challenges or difficulties which you can overcome. But, you know, do we understand stress as in this forum at the moment when you're talking about stress related to your divorces, your depression, or let's say your debt, or, you know, the extreme situation, because we're talking about high stress individual who believe that the stress is not harmful for you and then able to survive, and versus those people who believe had gone through, you know, was the question asked that what is the high level of stress? Because I hear all the examples which are, let's say, difficulty which you can overcome, and it's a mild amount of stress which,
yes,
you know, it's like a day-to-day thing. It's
no, I think you are underestimating what stress is. The daily stress that an individual faces
even if he's not going through a divorce, or even if he's not going through a bankruptcy, or bankers are not running after him, there is a lot of stress in daily life also. So today's talk, today's discussion is about those regular humdrum stresses that we deal with. Okay, and it is important to deal with those stresses also.
Absolutely.
Yeah?
Absolutely. Because actually, yeah.
Yeah. Gautam, do you have a question?
Hello.
I have a question, but just a couple of takeaways.
Yeah.
One is,
if you can get a mic to Gautam.
Yeah. Couple of takeaways from the session. One is about, you know, if I have to deal with stress better, recognizing symptoms, whether it's bodily or mentally, or talking to your family, friends, or so, recognizing symptoms is one first thing. The second thing is about the 4 A's you talked about and making the choice among the 4 A's.
Yeah.
That's where the tact or skill, our approach to management of stress comes in. Whether this is a situation, should I go for avoiding it? Should I go for accepting the challenge or the situation?
Yeah.
I think if we keep those two things, probably there's a lot, lot of improvement in our stress management.
And everybody will have their own solution. Narendra, you have to say.
Okay, he's just talking about one example. So whether it is physics, whether it is music, or whether it is life, personal life, you need an optimum level of stress to produce the music. I mean, take the example of sitar or guitar. So if the strings are not stretched to the optimum level, you can't produce a beautiful music. But at the same time, if you stretch it a bit harder, you will kind of
break the string.
Break the chord within two strokes.
Correct.
So we need to have that
optimized
stress, and we need to see how to manage it to produce the music we want to produce in the life which we have got. This is a beautiful life, we should be grateful, as Vinay mentioned.
Right.
We should be grateful for many things we have got. There are so many things which a lot of people don't have access to.
Correct.
So we should be thankful, grateful, and just produce the music. Everyone will be producing a different music.
Absolutely. Fantastic. So I'll quickly finish. Let's not spend. So one of the things that this study talks about is the heart's response, or the circulatory system's response to stress. The normal artery is like this, and when you're under stress, the artery constricts, the flow of blood becomes restricted, the heart has to pump faster to get the same amount of blood flow. And according to this study, when a person is under stress, but they understand the stress response of the body, their artery does not constrict. So that is a massive difference, and that is perhaps the reason why fewer people die, even if they are dealing with stressful situations, when they know their body's response to stress. So finally, some stress is not the problem. It is actually good, and it's called, actually, there's a term for it, eustress, which we rarely come across, but there is a term. It makes us tougher, stronger, more resilient, and more receptive to happiness and well-being. The real problem is not stress. It is the lack of recovery from stress.
Absolutely.
And I think if we do that better...
Absolutely.
Thanks a lot. Any other questions, we are welcome to discuss. Yes, ma'am.
Okay.
What I have is not a question. In your presentation today, two things were listed, like meditation and chanting. So actually in Powai we have quite a few opportunities. I mean, I would just like to mention, some of you may have heard of Sadhguru Jaggi Vasudev. So there are inner engineering programs conducted by Isha Foundation, which are really very good. I mean, I am a practitioner since 3 years. There are two programs which are going to be conducted in April. So if anyone is interested, I can post in the group. Plus, since last 1 year, there is also, there is this Hare Krishna movement, which is a branch of ISKCON. So, I feel that I chanced upon it just through a brochure, but it has really helped me. Like, last 1 year, I have been attending, and starting this week, it's going to be at Gopal Sharma School, Yoga for Happiness, and then there are also Gita Life classes.
Okay.
So, I think, on my personal experience, I can say, that some of this sort of spiritual nourishment is also helping me towards stress management. Thank you.
Manishya, can you wind up? And I'll just request everybody to stay for just about 5 minutes more. We just want to wind up. And thereafter, there's some announcements to be made.
So I guess a big round of applause. First, I'm saying, imagine for Asia Pacific CEO of a company to spare so much time and prepare this session, and for Vinay to also help in the preparation, and more important, to have the courage to reveal his own story. It's very, very, it's an act of courage. You know, and there's a term in English called vulnerability, vulnerable. So can I be publicly vulnerable? And it's not easy to express your innermost you know, stories, your deepest stories in front of public like this. And I guess that leaves a lot of mark because people can connect with that. People can connect with theory, but people can connect a lot better with real life, which, you know, I'm very thankful to Vinay for having the courage to express it and so openly share it with us. I have, you know, for the last week been wondering about my own personal stressors, and one of them I mentioned to you about this whole addiction to various devices, which, you know, unwittingly I have succumbed to, and I have seen children also succumbing to that very often. So I would request if all of us can have a few takeaways and practice some of those techniques, particularly, you know, don't lead your children to the path where they get addicted, because that will take them away from humanity, from physical, personal relationships, and ultimately will alienate them and cause a lot of stress in their lives, which today they may actually not realize. They can't realize, even we don't realize very often. So I would request all of us to have a few takeaways from the session and practice it, because they say information is fine. This is great information. But only with action will information lead to transformation. So I would urge all of you to take a few transformative steps in your life so that this session becomes meaningful, really meaningful, and worthy of effort that these fine gentlemen have put in. And your time that you've put in for this effort. Thanks, everyone. Thanks a lot for coming. And thank you. Good evening. And Gurdeep wants to make some announcement regarding... not...
Watermelons.
Watermelons. In fact, yeah. Last time we had Gurdeep's birthday, and I took two watermelons. So the concept was, so people wondering, why two watermelons? So I said, if you cut one, and it turns out not to be so tasty, then you have a fallback option. Because in cakes, you know, usually there's no issue, but in watermelons there's a risk. So, but I'm a big proponent of celebrating birthdays by actually cutting fruit like watermelon or melons or whatever. I want to stay my size 32. So I'm wearing the same trouser which I want to wear for many decades, hopefully. And I've been wearing the same trouser for many decades. So I want to stay that way, and I want to spread the message of health and wellness. So, yeah, I want to start a movement where people stop cutting cakes and start cutting fruit to celebrate birthdays. But other people don't listen, you know, my family, my friends.
The problem is you don't want to take a chance with watermelon, because there could be 10 watermelons and still you won't find a sweet one. And if you find a sweet one, most of them are adulterated. So, thanks a lot, Varun, and thank you, Vinay and Manish, for this excellent talk show we had today.